You know I've raved about outer before, and I love my outer sofa, outdoor dining table, and chairs. I've had them for over a year, and let me tell you, they've been through everything, from rainstorms to scorching sun, and still look brand new.
That's because outer makes outdoor furniture that's actually designed for the outdoors. From using incredibly durable and sustainable materials to developing innovative solutions like the outer shell cover, which protects my sofa and dining table against dust, debris, and dirt. No more soggy cushions or dusty tabletops. My outer setup is always clean, dry, and ready to be enjoyed anytime I want.
Head to liveouter.com/thefounderhour to see Outer's range of outdoor furniture, fire pits, and accessories. The Founder Hour listeners get an exclusive 10% off for a limited time. Terms and conditions apply.
So elevate your outdoor space with Outer. That's liveouter.com/thefounderhour.
Max, welcome to the show. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
So like we always do, we'd love to start from sort of the beginning and learn a little bit about your early days in your life, and then we'll talk about all the business stuff afterwards. You grew up in Ukraine up until I think you were around 16 years old. So tell us a little bit about that time. You know, what was it like? What were you like? What were you into? And then we'll talk about, you know, sort of all the stuff that comes after that.
I grew up in a scientist family. So all my immediate surroundings were people who took science very seriously. And the majority of my sort of immediate and near family are all physicists. So I was surrounded by people who talked about Nobel Prize in physics and things like variable star radiation. And as a kid, I would go with my grandmother to visit the Kiev Observatory and look into the cosmos through the largest telescope they had there. It was pretty cool. It was a really sort of a nerdy but exciting childhood. I was in one of these early tracked math and science programs in school, so they definitely pushed me pretty hard towards exploring science and math and things like that. And it was all good. And then my early teenagehood / late childhood was disrupted by the nuclear accident at Chernobyl, which is only about 60 miles north of Kiev, where I grew up. And that's where it put an interesting spin on things. I had to move to Crimea because that's where my family wanted to go to be away from the fallout, and kind of got dipped into a very different lifestyle where people around me were grape farmers and watermelon farmers and et cetera. So it was very rural, very kind of a very different from my lofty science family upbringing. So it exposed me to a just completely different lifestyle. And in aggregate, somewhere between those two, I got really interested in computers, initially as a way of just exploring some of the conversations that I had with my family, understanding, you know, them when they talk about data. And these were like Soviet computers, so they're, you know, made out of very large hunks of iron, basically. But even that was really cool and exciting. And my mom, she worked at a research institute that I would visit sometimes. And in her lab, she had some ancient Soviet computers, ancient by today's standards at the time, and they were shiny and cool. So I got a chance to play the original Tetris when, like, literally as it was being introduced in Soviet Union, as this was happening in the late 80s, and so on. And then, so living in Crimea, I was suddenly very far from all of my math and science friends, and it was kind of a normal school, and the homework was boring because I'd already taken all these classes back where I was from. And so I started trying to learn as much as I could about computers and programming, in part because I was so bored. And then eventually we moved back to Kiev, and I was suddenly back to my normal stomping grounds of lots of access to science and scientists and interesting books.
And Max, Max, are you teaching yourself, or, you know, how were you learning?
I was mostly teaching myself. The sort of the rabbit hole was in my mom's lab. They got a Z80 powered East German made computer called Robotron 1715. Like, this was the moment of the pill that I took was in a form of a fairly large desktop, green screen only, East German made computer called Robotron, not to be confused with a video game. And inside it was the East German clone of the Z80 chip. So it was very low power, but you could program it. And you could really program it. It had compilers. So it ran CPM80, which is a now ancient operating system, but it looks remarkably similar to things like DOS and a little bit of command line Unix. And so suddenly you have this thing, which isn't like a calculator. It has real programming capabilities, and you have a text editor. You can go in and write code. And initially you had to learn assembly language, which in the case of Z80 is just not very hard. But then pretty quickly, they somehow got a copy of Turbo Pascal 3.0. And I was suddenly exposed to high-level programming languages. And that was sort of it. Like, you're inside the Iron Curtain, so there aren't books, there aren't manuals available, so you kind of have to piece it together. And so I would literally go to my mom's lab and be like, all right, have you gotten anything new about how to program? Because it's so cool, so interesting. She'd be like, oh yeah, somebody gave me the Xeroxed book. And I got a copy of like a bootleg translated, very, very famous book by Nicolaus Wirt, who was a designer of Pascal, the language, the programming language, titled Algorithms Plus Data Structures Equals Programs. And that is like a seminal text for a lot of people in the mid 80s, early 90s on learning how to program in Pascal. And it was really poorly translated. And even worse, it was Xeroxed. So some of the pages were unreadable. So I was learning how to program, but you're like, all right, so well, this page is completely unreadable. What do I do? Anyway, and so that was kind of one. And then I would go to all these technical bookstores and like beg them to look in the back of the room if there's any books about programming. And they'd be like, yeah, we have this book. It's called Proving Theorems with the Prolog Programming Language. Like, that doesn't sound useful at all. I'm going to buy this book and read it anyway because it's programming. And so you would have all these like constellations of near knowledge that I would just absorb as much as I could. One of my more
fun. How old were you at this time that you're doing all
this? I started about 10 or 11. And then we moved to Crimea and back sort of in a span of around sort of 1986, back by 1988 or so. So I was by then a teenager. But one of the more sort of hilarious things that I did in retrospect, which I think, you know, I'd like to believe or at least tell the story that it made me more who I am and more disciplined, is I had no access to a computer for a majority of my time. And so I had these notebooks and I would go to this bench that I sort of earmarked as my bench in this park right next to our house or our apartment and would write programs in longhand on paper. And I had all these notebooks where I had designed, sketched, written out in longhand in Turbo Pascal, everything from like re-implementing Tetris or building a very small calculator or trying to design something of like my own video game. And at some point I was sort of like, well, these are useless. I'll never type them up because they're too big. But I read about debugging and the idea that you need to be like, you need to write code that's actually like not just mostly right, but completely right. Like, well, I need to do debugging on paper now. So I had like a little sheet of paper that I put aside, be like, all right, so we're executing this code line by line. What happens if this condition is not met? So I would paper code and paper debug, which in retrospect seemed like I must have had the patience of a saint when I was doing this. But these days, you couldn't convince me to do it by hand. But at the time, it was the only option.
Did you ever like actually run that code?
I did. So when I would come to my mom's lab, I would have like this book because I only had a limited amount of time. Like, this computer was shared. There were lots of other researchers. And so I'd be like allowed in, and she would have to negotiate time with her coworkers, like, hey, let my kid hang out in this computer. So I'd be like, I got to type this up as quickly as I can. And then one of the things that actually was really amusing, majority of these computers had no storage. So a lot of the time I would retype it from scratch every time. And then I would play with it, like, all right, I have some bugs, I need to fix them. I'm going to go fix them on my paper. And then the next time, like the next day or the next week when I would come in, I would retype it again from scratch because there was no way to store it. And eventually, and that's not because the machines didn't have a disk drive, they had a hard drive. So you have to bring your own floppy. But if you're in the middle of Soviet Union, in the middle of the 80s, you can't actually buy a floppy disk. Like, you're not going to walk into a store and be like, need a pack of floppies. And so at some point, I had to like hunt down someone who would sell me basically contraband floppy disks. And it turned out to be my chemistry teacher in my middle school. And I have no idea where he got bad. His floppy disk. Yeah, exactly. It was like a very weird thing where I went to my parents and said, hey, somebody's willing to sell me some floppy disks. That would be great. And they're like, all right, but do you have any money? Like, no, I thought you might give me some. Like, it's a lot of money for floppy disks. So it was like a very awkward thing where I had to go back to them and be like, can I buy just one floppy disk instead of a pack?
Were there other kids like you, or were you just kind of, you know, this is something that you enjoyed on your own time, and like, or were you also like nerding out with other kids?
Initially, I thought I was the only child in Kiev, the only boy in Kiev who wanted to learn how to program, but it turned out that it was not true. In fact, there are actually a whole bunch of kids like me, and we sort of found each other over time. I was introduced. So my mom knew someone who had a kid who was similarly predisposed, and they're like, oh, we got to get our sons together because like they don't get outside. They just sit around and write code on paper. And so I got together with this dude, and he turned out to be significantly more advanced than I was, because somehow someone in his family traveled outside of Soviet Union and got like a manual in Polish on how to program. And so we were like, and my dad knew Polish, so he could translate some parts of it for us. And so it was like all sort of a DIY programming. But through this kid, I found out that there's a club somewhere on the outskirts of town where kids talked about video games, and some of the really smart kids knew about making video games. So I visited that, but it was all very like, I mean, today, you know, you can go online and learn how to program all day long, but, or join any number of clubs and groups. At the time, it was like, there were probably 24 kids like that in a 6-7 million person city. But going from I know zero people to I know at least a handful was really powerful.
Yeah. So I think it was around 91. You were 16 years old when your family moved to America, moved to Chicago. And then I know it was tough, kind of financially on your family early on. Can you share a little bit about that time and that kind of time in your life and how that impacted you and sort of what you ended up, you know, obviously the path that you ended up going on?
Yeah. The interesting wrinkle in the story was that my family was not especially well-to-do in Soviet Union, but because we knew we were about to move, so we had about year and a half between the time that we got our refugee asylum letter from the US and the actual move, we'd sort of slowly pieced together a bunch of savings. So we were about to enter the US with the ruble equivalent of like $6,000. So, which in the late 80s, early 90s would have been a lot of money. So would have been at least initially comfortable as we were trying to look for jobs, etc. And literally few weeks before we were to go and exchange our currency for dollars, Soviet Union executed essentially a devaluation of the currency. And so we ended up with something on the order of $600 instead of 6,000. It was basically 1 for 10. And in the moment, I was kind of like, okay, well, sure. And my parents were devastated and I couldn't figure out why. First, when we got to the US, we're like, yeah, we have enough money to pay rent for 1 month. That's it. And then like, we have to scramble. We had a very distant relative in Chicago, which is how we ended up there in the first place, who kind of said, well, like, you know, whatever happens, we'll make sure you guys are not destitute and out in the streets. But we kind of came into the US expecting at least some breathing room, which very quickly became zero breathing room at all. So my dad, with his multiple advanced degrees, was basically working as a substitute painter at like a tiny little studio. And by studio, I mean like they would paint grocery signs for like local grocery stores. And my mom was a babysitter with her own advanced degrees in physics and computer science. And so for a little while, we're like definitely scraping by to the extreme. I was basically spared because I was just young enough where I couldn't really do meaningful earning, although I did get a job at a computer store very briefly. And my primary value add was I would tell buyers of these early 90s Windows or DOS really machines about all the amazing things you can do with them. But I was mostly hired to clean the floors there. And so my job there was not, in fact, a salesperson, as I was told by the store manager once, like, you're not actually here to sell computers, you're here to clean the floors.
Why did your family choose Chicago as
a distant relative? Like the standard immigration reality where you just go to where you have someone or know someone who might be a support
Right. Bigger. And what was Chicago like at the time? I mean, was it this? I mean, this is now 33 years ago. Mm-hmm. I know that because Pat and I are born not so long after that. But you know, and like that's the only reason that math worked out so quickly. But what was the city like? What was kind of going on at the time there? And what was your impression of it as a younger kid?
So for me, Chicago is home. Like at this point, I think when somebody asks me where you're from, I answer Chicago. And when they say like, you have a trace of an accent, like, okay, fine. I was born in Ukraine, but actually Chicago is where I grew up. And it was pretty awesome. I mean, to me, Chicago was America. So I came from the other side of the Iron Curtain where I understood how things worked, but a lot of things were limited. A lot of things were like, you couldn't tell certain types of jokes because you might get reported and arrested, and sort of all sorts of fears were suddenly eliminated. And so in that sense, it was amazing. It was also very much, in my mind at least, a single story town or city, where in Soviet Union, everything was these apartment complex after apartment complex. No one lived in a house. Everyone lived in an apartment. And so just visually and architecturally, it was super interesting. The other thing that was really amazing about Chicago, and it sort of shaped me in a way, much greater way than I recognized at the time and now really appreciate. So because we came in basically penniless, this whole idea of like, well, you know, Max is a smart kid, he's going to go to a really good high school, was like thrown out the window. Like, all right, so what is the nearest school you can go to where you don't have to pay anything? So I went to the nearest inner city public high school, which was 30% Asian, 30% Black, 30% not sort of from around here. So it was entirely an immigrant / minority / kind of a mix of everything. And if you are coming from a place where everyone looks pasty white, Eastern European, then the only differentiation is, are you Jewish or are you not Jewish, which I am. More. And in Soviet Union, it was a point of discrimination. In Chicago, nobody cared. I could have told them I'm from Mars, and they'd be like, yeah, we got two of those over there too. Like, just everyone was from somewhere else. Everyone was just completely indifferent to your past and only cared, are you a smart kid? Are you someone I can copy the homework from? And so I was able to very quickly find my people, and those people were not just more of the same. In fact, I immediately befriended like one of each. And the idea of sort of, you can fit in here without trying too hard, was inculcated from like the moment I showed up to the US. And some of my best friends today are still the kids that I met in that first couple of weeks in Chicago high school.
You know, what's also interesting is, you know, being a kid that was so into computers, I feel like that could have probably been the best place you could have come to, because it, you know, seemingly there's a lot happening. You know, I know you went to the University of Illinois and studied computer science there. And that was like one of the few places in America, I think, at the time, early internet, you know, Netscape, Mark Andreessen was there. I think you guys overlapped a couple of years or something like that. So there's a lot happening in that scene, and coincidentally, you kind of land there and are part of that scene, right? And so tell us a little bit about that time and like what you got exposed to there that perhaps, you know, inspired you to go into startups and technology.
Yeah, that was extreme luck. In fact, probably the luckiest point of my life was deciding to go to University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign in 1993. So I was in Chicago, early 90s. There were definitely interesting things happening around me. Like the thing to do, which I was exposed to as soon as I got there, really, as soon as I got to high school, was dialing up into PBSs. You guys actually may be too young to even know what that is, but pre-public
internet. What was that?
BBS, Bulletin Board Systems. So it's it's basically, exactly, you're nodding with a question in your eyes. So back before there were things like network cards, there were these things called modems, and a lot of them were outside, little box that you plug into your phone and on one side and into your computer on the other, and you dial up. You call a system out there, and typically BBSs were essentially someone else's desktop computer that could take on one or more phone lines. You would go call in, log in, where you had credentials, username and password, and you'd leave messages for other people. And that was sort of the earliest version of networking, one of the earliest versions of networking. And so I was very into it. In fact, I got into a lot of hot water with my parents because back then, calling long distance was not the same price as calling local. So you were constantly optimizing for, well, I got to call this BBS. but it's outside of my area code. Oh man, am I going to get in trouble? So, and like the standard event from the late 80s, early 90s in America is your parents pick up the phone while you're online. And it's like screeching. If you ever heard of a fax in a movie, like that, the screech. Yeah,
we're old enough to remember that.
Yeah. So that's like that's BBS calling. So anyway, so I was super into BBSs. And then I get accepted into U of I and I get my letter, like a physical letter saying, hey, by the way, here's your on-campus computer access. Like when you move down to Champaign, you can just go to the nearest lab and type in this username and password and you'll be on your Unix system. Like Unix systems, never heard of this. They're like, but if you want to try it now, here's a phone number. We have a BBS in Chicago. You can dial that up and go. So I call this BBS number, just mostly because I've called hundreds of them over the last couple of years. And I get a Unix prompt. And I've never seen a Unix prompt, but I'm very comfortable around DOS and other kind of similar operating systems. So I was like, all right, I'm going to explore this thing. And so I sort of moderately quickly figure out what I can try. And I run IRC, Internet Relay Chat. And if you ever use IRC, it's like Slack or Discord or any one of these multi-room chat environments, but it's the original one. And in that moment, in the early 90s, IRC was exploding. And so you go from, I'm dialing up this one line and I'm talking to one person or two people at best, but mostly I'm leaving offline messages and somebody else will come in and read and respond, to you can talk to literally hundreds of thousands of people in real time, just as you type, they're typing back. And there are channels for everything. Channels called, so it used to be like, actually Slack kind of mimicked a lot of this. So pound hackers and pound coders and pound UIUC students. And you're suddenly surrounded by hundreds of thousands of people all communicating about whatever topics you want to talk about. And that was like the moment where my head just blew up in lights. And like, I will never ever dial a BBS again. I'm only going to do this from now on. And so I moved down to Champaign to save on phone bills way ahead of the actual class start, because I didn't want to dial up and cost my parents any more money. Just wanted to be there so I can be on IRC all day, every day. And that was sort of the beginning of the current. So Mark and I didn't really know each other well on campus, but he was sort of a well-known character because he was working at NCSA, which gave birth to everything from Mosaic to the original web server, HTTPD, Mosaic, NCSA, HTTPD, and other projects were being worked on by him and his friends. And just by being near it, you were exposed to whatever the cutting edge of the internet, public internet was, even before web was a thing. And then, of course, in 93 is when Mosaic Beta launched. And we went from everything's a green screen, everything's a command line, to actually everything is a window of a browser. And you can look at graphics online. And that was the moment.
Okay, listen up. It's 2024. Are you still using your personal phone number for your startup? One of the most common founder mistakes I see is using your personal phone for business. OpenPhone has completely rethought every detail of what a business phone should look like and do in 2024. OpenPhone makes it super easy to get business phone numbers for your whole team. It works through a beautiful app on your phone or computer and integrates with CRMs like HubSpot and Salesforce. It's the number one business phone on G2 for customer satisfaction with over 1,700 reviews. And here's a feature that I love personally. With OpenPhone's AI-powered call transcripts and summaries, you can have a summary of your phone call with action items right when you hang up. No more note-taking or forgotten to-dos. What's more is that every employee that's sharing that phone number with you has access to it too. Total recall across your entire team. OpenPhone is already affordable at a starting price of $15 per user per month. But for a limited time, the Founder Hour listeners can get 20% off for 6 months. And if you have existing numbers with another service, OpenPhone will port them over at no extra charge. Head to openphone.com/founder to start your free trial and get 20% off.
Max, if you kind of look back, you know, 25, 30 years or just around that time that you started going to college, and, you know, knowing obviously what you knew then, knowing what you know now, did you as either, you know, yourself, right? Like, did you ever think, visualize, dream, and maybe even others, like, you know, that were like you, that the internet would be what it has become at the time, or that it has the potential to become what it has become? Or was it more just, you know, there wasn't really an application for it yet, and it was just all these things that were happening, but it wasn't very clear? I'm just curious what your mindset was, you know, 30 years ago now on where we would potentially be.
So I got a very early cheat code in a sense. So I went to U of I to become just like one of my relatives. I was going to get a PhD. I was already a bit of a controversial child where everyone was telling me, well, obviously you're going to go major in this goofy computer science thing, but it's not a real science. The real science is physics. And then you're going to get a graduate degree in physics. And then you're going to be the best of us and win the Nobel Prize. And I was sort of like, sure. But I really like computer science and I want to program and do stuff like that. And so I was sort of first half a year, maybe pretending like this PhD idea was still going to work out for me. But just being sort of pre-web, I saw so much usage of the internet right there and then. I was like, this has got to be big. Like my class schedule is online. My course registration is moving online. If I need to find my professor's phone number or office hours or get in touch with another student in some other university to share research, it's all online. Like this is like a thing that I did not anticipate for my BBS dialing up days, but boy, is it really useful. And then literally 6 months later, you see Netscape and all these things suddenly happening very, very quickly. And lots of kids I knew were starting to talk about, well, this whole like graduating with a bachelor's degree is overrated. We should go start a company. And like starting companies was not in the vernacular of a Soviet refugee. So I was like, okay, starting company sounds exciting, but like, what does that really mean? And as I was sort of just starting to look around and ask myself, like, am I really going to be here for the next 8 years getting the graduate degree? These two kids invited me to join their startup. And the whole thing blew up very quickly and wasn't really real. But I was sort of like, huh, so that's like starting a company, right? And they're like, yeah. Like, so what do I have to do? Like, well, just have to write code. Like, you're already writing code all day, every day. Just write code with us for this thing we have in mind. Their startup was built around the notion of the web is going to be huge. Is going to have lots of people doing stuff on it, whatever that stuff may be. And anything that has big audiences will eventually have advertising. And aggregating audiences, selling ads, powering those ad networks is going to be a big deal. Someone's got to do it, might as well be us. And we were not, in fact, the winner of this particular market, but we were probably one of the earliest people in web advertising who were thinking about this thing. And so I was, whether I believed it fully or not, I was very early to this notion of the web is going to be a commercial thing. It's not going to be just like a thing where people publish their PhD research papers. There'll be buying and selling. There'll be advertising. There'll be lots of interesting things happening of commercial nature on the web. And so by the time I sort of said, well, is this what I'm going to do with myself for the rest of my life? The answer was definitely yes, because it's so cool and so much fun. But more importantly, I never doubted that it'll be huge because, you know, I was convinced very early on that it's just a matter of how many times you need to try to do something that'll work. And so I think unlike others, I got sort of roped into doing my first startup. And by the time it failed, I was like, oh, there's nothing else I'd rather do.
Yeah. So at some point, you head west, you know, Silicon Valley, Palo Alto. And I think I heard that you walked into a lecture at Stanford and that's how you met Peter Thiel, who you eventually started PayPal with. Tell us about that encounter. You know, what was that first encounter like? How did you guys click? Like, how did you guys decide, you know, this is someone that's going to be my co-founder and someone I want to start a business with?
It wasn't entirely an accident. So first of all, I was living on the floor of one of my co-founders from that first advertising company that failed. So he had moved to Silicon Valley a couple of years ahead of me. I was crashing on his floor because I was, as usual, broke, and we had no air conditioning. And so he was like, hey, one cheat code for air conditioning is you go and sit in classes at Stanford because they have excellent air conditioning and maybe you'll learn something, maybe you snooze in the back, but like all day long air conditioning, great stuff. And so the punchline was that I got to this air conditioned class and I knew it was being given by the guy, Peter Thiel, that some people from my immediate surroundings had already met, including, I think, the guy whose floor I was crashing on, where he said, you know, all things kept equal, he's an interesting character. Like, you will learn something in his lecture. Like, you may not be able to fall asleep because he tells a great story. And so it turned out, I was sort of like, oh yeah, I know that name. I'm going to go walk into that class and snooze in the back if it's not interesting. Two things were, unfortunately or fortunately for all of us, true. It was not, in fact, a lecture. It was like a talk and maybe six other people were in attendance in a tiny little room. So falling asleep was not an option. Like, you had to sit there and basically in a second row and just sort of, and It was about the size of a broom closet too. So it was a very small room, very small number of people. But Peter's also very compelling. He was telling all these things and was like, all right, it's like, he sees the world through a very different lens. I knew very little about things like currency trading and markets. And his talk was on arbitrage and currencies, the worldwide currency trading. And so I was like, this is super interesting. I have no idea half the words he's using, but he's obviously super passionate. He's really smart. And he's also very young. Like, I fully expected people who do stuff with markets to be like these grizzled kind of veterans of Wall Street, which I knew very little about at the time, but he was basically my age. And afterwards, I came up to introduce myself, which was not normally my MO, but because I knew we had at least one shared contact, so, well, you know, I'm Max and you know my friend Luke, my friend Scott. And he's like, oh, cool. So what do you do with yourself, Max? And I'm like, I start companies. You know, they mostly fail, but I start companies. He's like, oh, that's great. Love company starting. We should get together for breakfast. I'm like, okay, that sounds like an extremely cool idea. And they're like, yeah, let's get together tomorrow morning, 9 a.m. And that was sort of like the moment. And the next day we got together for breakfast and he was like, all right, tell me about the companies you're going to start now that you moved to Silicon Valley. And he knew that I just moved from Illinois. And I pitched him on two ideas. And one of them was basically PayPal, or what turned out to lead to PayPal. And the other one was something that's lost.
FieldLink, I think.
FieldLink, right, was the original name and became Confinity and eventually became PayPal. And then the other idea was not to be. And so he literally was like, all right, this FieldLink idea is great. I would like to invest. Like, all right, like that's pretty amazing. Like, I just met this guy last night at a college lecture in the middle of the summer. And he's offering me $300,000 to back my idea that I kind of thought through while I was driving cross country to get to Palo Alto. That's awesome. And so that was sort of moment number one. And then, but he meant it. So he was like, all right, so we got to incorporate you. We got to get you a cap table. We need to make sure you have the right number of shares issued. And like, I don't remember doing any of this stuff when I was starting my companies in Illinois. Like, those are all like kind of a handshaky deals. And so he was very serious very quickly. And as this went on, he was like, well, like, you got to recruit some people, you got to build a team, we got to like start building equity value here. And it's like, okay, that I know. I knew some other really smart kids at U of I. I started pinging them like, hey, should we do something together again? Because some of them worked for my previous startups. So as this was going on, I was rapidly becoming convinced that I just want to write code and lead the engineering team. And someone else should be doing the other thing that Peter was pushing very hard. And he's like, look, you know, I can't be the only backer. Like, $300,000 isn't going to be enough. Like, I've never seen $300,000 in my life. So I think it's going to be infinite amount of money. Like, no. Like, you don't understand. You need to raise at least $1 million. We got to go and raise another round of financing afterwards. So he was already on like the track for the next round. And he's like, all right.
What had Peter Thiel done up to that point? I mean, had he already started a company or two, or?
So he was a Stanford law graduate. He then moved to New York and worked for SNC, Sloan Crumble, for like a little bit of time. And it was like, oh my God, I don't want to be a lawyer. So he walked out of that, went across the street, apparently literally, and became a trader. So he had some background in trading, I think, futures on Wall Street.
Right.
And that too was like, oh, this is too boring, not exciting enough, or something along those lines. Hmm. And he moved back to California, where he grew up, and started a hedge fund, which at the time was like a very new idea. Hedge funds were not yet right, widely understood. So he had a $10 million hedge fund, which now sounds like a joke, but this was, you know, this is right, quite some time ago. So
that's like a seed stage today.
Yeah. Like that's like the seed round, not even the valuation. And so he was running this $10 million hedge fund. And then very quickly he realized that actually the most interesting thing he could do as a hedge fund investor is invest in these startups that all of his friends in California were starting. So he became known as the hedge fund guy who likes to fund private companies instead of hedging public security or public equities. And so he had started a company at the time, I think it was called Thiel Capital. And that was his thing. And so my goal became persuading Peter Thiel to put Thiel Capital on ice and become the chief executive officer of FieldLink. That was sort of like a multi-month project where I pitched him on it pretty much immediately. He was like, that sounds like a crazy idea. Like, I'm not so sure about this. And I sort of kept on leaning into like, I'm really, really bad at all the CEOing things, but I'm a pretty good coder. Like, right, you want me coding as much as possible. And so at some point he was like, all right, fine, I accept.
And so his head was like already sort of in the finance space. And when you were kind of conceiving this idea of FieldLink, like on your trip, you know, west, was it
I know it was like storing encrypted data on like PDAs and Palm Pilots and things like that. But were you thinking like financial information? Were you thinking
not yet
like digital yet. Wallets or did that come after you and Peter?
This was well after. In fact, you can kind of trace the history of the company through name changes. So originally it was FieldLink, which the idea was there are people out there with these Palm Pilots, PDAs out in the field. Maybe they're salespeople. Maybe they're like installing refrigerators. Who knows? But there'll be some data they need to take with them, and the data will be private. And in my mind, private data was like secret documents and like price lists and things that people don't like to share. And so we need some encryption for that. And these chips, back to my Z80 exploits in Soviet Union, these chips are really dumb. They don't have any power at all. So doing like hardcore encryption on it is really hard. So there's an opportunity to bring my super coder skills to do better than that. And so that's what I was prototyping when I was hanging around in Palo Alto. And that's what I pitched Peter. And he was like, that sounds like a really good idea. Like maybe instead of, you know, talking to salespeople in the field, you might want to like talk to people on Wall Street who are encrypting contracts or encrypting, you know, maybe they're logging into their corporate network and picking up some important data that way. And so that started to drift. At some point, we became convinced that there's room to do something there very broadly around document encryption. And the company was renamed Confinity, which I named. So you can tell I'm not a marketer, but it stood for Confidence and Infinity. And this guy, Reid Hoffman, who was Peter's friend from Stanford, was hanging around our office and said, Confinity. So like, you're going to name a company about security with the word con as the opening. That's great. Like, it's really not going to be great. So to his credit, we were brainstorming, what else might you encrypt? And I think it was Reid, although there's differing versions of this particular event, but Reid was definitely in the room, but there were several of us, including Peter and me and a couple other folks, who basically said, well, one thing you can encrypt is IOUs. The idea of like when I write down something on a piece of paper and say, I owe you $10, if you encrypt it or at least signed it cryptographically, it would be as valid as a check as opposed to like a piece of paper you can rip up and say, I don't owe you anything. So that was like the rabbit hole where like, okay, so you could encrypt promissory notes, which is a fancy word for IOUs, but then you kind of want to also handle the part where you're settling the promissory note. When I'm paying you back the $10 that I owe you, how do we do that? And so we built what eventually became PayPal in that exploration. Like, so I gave you an IOU, which I was very excited about because it's cryptographically secure. That's what I wanted to work on. Like the whole part where I pay you back at whatever. So not that interesting. In the process, we discovered that actually paying you back online was not a problem anybody had solved. And a couple more steps occurred where I built a demo of this thing that ran just on the web. You didn't have to have a Palm Pilot, which I also found to be just an absolutely deplorable use of time. Like, you know, Palm Pilots are the future. This whole web thing is like kind of in its infancy. Mm-hmm. Don't know what's going to happen here. I was really excited about Palm Pilots as devices. And at this point, by the way, I look like a total visionary because I was obviously saying things like, well, you know, eventually we're going to transact with iPhones, but iPhones were, you know, at least 20 years ahead of us. But in the moment, very few people had a Palm Pilot, but lots of people, like millions of people are now on the web, and eBay was a thing. So eBay sellers noticed the demo and appropriated it to just settle transactions for eBay sales. And that was the moment where like, oh my God, like the real demand here is not about Palm Pilots at all, or even about IOUs. It's just as simple as people got to pay for stuff online. And right now it's like literally cash on delivery or send me a check in the mail or all these stupid, slow, insecure methods. And so PayPal then became renamed PayPal because we were like the super friendly way of paying for things. So it was your payments pal.
And I know PayPal, you know, was a massive success, went public, thinking early 2002, and then a few months later was acquired by eBay. And then, you know, there's the famous PayPal Mafia, which everyone's talked about, and it's highly documented, and the merger with X.com that brought Elon into the company, and kind of this like incredible group of people that went on to build the companies we know and love today, which is amazing. And I know, just to kind of, because I know we want to talk about Affirm and everything you're doing now, but at some point, I think you, there was something called the Godbeck-Levchin test that commercialized CAPTCHAs. I don't know. Uh-huh. If I know people know that, may or may not know that about you, but CAPTCHAs are these things that everyone kind of has experienced. And you know, if you've been online and had to like type in, like, you know, click on the boxes that are, or, you know, that are birds or whatever, but why did you think that was something that had to be commercialized?
So it was entirely out of necessity. So first of all, this is one of these fairly common, apparently, situations where two reasonably smart people think of the same idea at roughly the same time. So CAPTCHA was named by this guy, Louis von Ahn, who now runs Duolingo and is just a brilliant computer scientist who was at CMU at the time. He built essentially a reverse Turing test that he wanted to create to verify that you're human. What makes you human? Ability to spot a fire hydrant in a 9x9 grid of images of various things. So, you know, it was initially much, much simpler than that, but as computer vision algorithms became smarter, captures had to become more sophisticated. At exactly the same time, in Palo Alto, we were fighting fraud. One of the many, many different kinds of payment fraud we were fighting was this, the vector of attack, as they call it in security. These Eastern European, ironically perhaps, hackers were signing up for PayPal tens, twenties, thousands of accounts per day. The reason they were doing this is because they would have these sort of puppeteerable accounts, and then they would steal some credit card database, which these days is super common. Back then it was very rare. And they needed to launder the money. So they would move money from account to account to account to account, making it very hard for us to investigate the original source of money. And then they would withdraw it by sort of faking a sale on eBay or something like that. And we needed to stop it because, among other things, eventually the original cardholder would say, hey, this wasn't my transaction, I need to charge it back, and we would be on the hook for it. So we were eating these enormous losses, and we pretty quickly identified that if we would just find who's signing up for these thousands of accounts, or at least prevent them from signing up for these accounts willy-nilly, we may be able to slow them down. And so I was literally sitting around raking my brain over the idea of how do I only make sure that one human can sign up for one account at a time. And I sort of formulated the problem. So I was trying to write down, like, what is the puzzle I'm really trying to crack? And eventually I sort of said out loud, I think what I need is something that computers are really bad at and humans are really good at. And this guy, David Gausbeck, who is also now a founder and for a while was CEO and I think now chief scientist of a company called Matterport, sort of poked his head out of his cubicle and said, OCR. Optical character recognition. You and I can read stuff really easily, even if it's crappy handwriting, and computers are terrible at OCR. And so I was like, that is the most brilliant thing you've ever said, Dave. And I sprinted to Fry's Electronics, sadly no more, but at the time there was one nearby. And I drove back with literally five different kinds of boxed OCR software, something that would take handwritten or printed text and try to convert it into digital documents, and then build something, which is what you see today as CAPTCHA, where it would print out this mangled text and run it through OCR packages that I just bought to see if it could solve it. And sure enough, it couldn't. Like, all right, so from now on, every time you're signing up for PayPal, you're going to have to solve one of these stupid puzzles. And I know it's going to be annoying, but it's going to be really annoying for those Eastern European bad guys. And one of them was actually so annoyed, he emailed me essentially an FU email because he was so mad that we prevented him from stealing money, which was, for a time, my proudest moment in life, perhaps, was this guy who I bested in the battle of wits.
That's awesome.
I did not know about Lewis's project for another decade until I randomly met a professor of his who told me, like, you guys keep on claiming that you invented CAPTCHA. You didn't. One of my graduate students did. And I was like, oh. And so eventually I met Lewis as well.
That's awesome. So after you sell PayPal to eBay, you end up leaving and then starting Slide, which is another company in 2004, and then sold it to Google about 6 years later, like $182 million or something like that. And then joined Google as VP of engineering. And then I think about a year after that, they shut down Slide. And so you ended up leaving. And then you started a firm called HVF, which around 2012, which stands for Hard, Valuable, and Fun. And I think that's what where a firm was born, through that sort of fund. So tell us about like the thesis of HVF, Hard, Valuable, and Fun. What were you trying to sort of accomplish with that thesis? And then, you know, what really inspired a firm originally?
Yeah. So HVF actually is a shorthand of a lesson I learned from Peter. So during PayPal, one night he walked in on me writing code. I was in the office and I don't know what he was doing there, but I was there at 2 o'clock in the morning writing code. And he asked me, are you working on something for PayPal? I said, no, I'm just solving this whatever random problem. Certainly don't remember now what it was. I said, oh, why do you want to work on this at 2 o'clock in the morning? I said, well, it's really hard. But you know, there's a really important thing to remember. Things that are really valuable are typically quite hard. And things that are really hard are not always valuable. In fact, there's plenty of ways to beat your head against the wall until your head bleeds. But even if the wall gives, there's nothing behind the wall. And so if it stayed with me, I was like, you have to be really thoughtful about when you're choosing a hard problem, will anybody care if you do solve it? And I think in his telling, it was sort of the difference between academia and industry, that academics don't mind solving hard problems for the sake of hard problems. And in the industry or commercial sense, you really want to solve something that's really valuable. It just so happens that the easy ones have all been picked off a long time ago. So I sort of operated in that mode for a long time. And then one day I sort of realized that during Slide, building games and building sort of media properties that we were doing then was actually quite hard. It turned out to be a very difficult problem. And it was fairly profitable. The sale to Google certainly, you know, didn't hurt. But throughout, weirdly enough, video games are actually not a lot of fun for me. I don't like video games, and I'm not a big fan of gaming and game design, although I appreciate it for the art form that it is. And so I sort of wrote down like a little short note for myself, you know, next time you start a company, make sure it's hard, because those are the important ones, that it's valuable, so you're not wasting your time, and then it's fun, that you actually enjoy it, that you'd be willing to enjoy solving the problem for a very long time. And with that framework, I sort of rented an office and sat in it with some friends and asked myself over and over again, like, what would be the next company that would fit all three of these H, V, and F criteria? And for a while, I was like, well, whatever I do cannot be in payments, cannot be in financial services, because I've done it before. How can I possibly beat my freshman act with something, you know, it'll never be as big as PayPal. And my wife, who was my girlfriend during PayPal and became my wife shortly after, was the one who said, you know, you're kind of keep on avoiding this area of work that is kind of your favorite, something you're good at. You've demonstrated you're good at this. Like, why wouldn't you look at financial services? It doesn't have to be payments. It doesn't have to be PayPal competitor, but at least give it a chance. Like, go look again. And at the time, I was hanging out with a friend of mine from as early as high school, college friend, and PayPal co-conspirator called Nathan, who eventually became co-founder of Palantir. And so Nathan ran risk engineering for me at PayPal, but we're friends for a long time, and we stayed really close touch even after PayPal. And we were having lunch, as we did sort of recurrently every month or so. And I'd ask him, like, in the world of payments, what did we not do when we were at PayPal? And the weirdest thing to him, he said, was we did all these really clever risk scoring algorithms for anti-fraud, like this CAPTCHA thing that we co-invented, et cetera. But we never touched credit, even though credit is by far the most important component of payments. Like, every transaction is a credit transaction. If you're paying someone with your credit card, that's credit. If you're paying someone with your debit card, it won't settle for a day or two. Someone is taking the risk that you actually have the money in your account. If you're paying someone with ACH, which is your bank account payment, it's even more risky because that settles over 3 to 4 days, at least in this country. And so there's always risk. So someone is always underwriting the probability that you may not have the funds and essentially selling insurance against that eventuality. And so that was sort of like, huh, fascinating. So we could have easily built these algorithms because we were really good at machine learning. We were inventing some of the stuff that's now standard. Like, we used random forests before anybody else did, and all sorts of fun, really important machine learning discoveries were kind of used and or accidentally invented at PayPal. And I was like, you know, I really should look at credit. And initially, Affirm was just going to be, let's build a better credit score. Credit scoring is outdated. There's this FICO score. It's been around forever. I remembered also as an immigrant going back to the early 90s, trying to get a credit card was super difficult. I didn't have a rating, didn't have a record. And then I eventually got a credit card, which I confused how to use correctly, promptly destroyed my credit score, couldn't get another credit card for a long time. So all of that seemed like, oh, there's at least an opportunity to find younger versions of Max or Max 20 years ago and give them better access to credit. So that was the original idea. And the more I learned about credit and how it's really done underneath, which is sort of a shocker that I didn't learn it earlier, but I really did go through the full learning experience of, like, how does credit really work for consumers in the US in the very beginnings of Affirm, I got more and more incensed about how completely archaic and in many ways deeply unfair the whole thing is. And it's like, you know, actually, this isn't just like an opportunity to build a better score. It's an opportunity to build better credit, like much, much, much bigger vision than just like, let's go compete with a FICO score. And so we started in fairly humble origins, but fairly quickly decided we're just going to go build a better credit product, full stop, for anyone who wants something that doesn't suck.
Customers are rushing to your store. Do you have a point of sale system you can trust, or is it a real POS? You need Shopify for retail. Shopify POS is your command center for your retail store. From accepting payments to managing inventory, Shopify has everything you need to sell in person. Get hardware that fits your business. Take payments by smartphone, transform your tablet into a point-of-sale system, or use Shopify's POS Go mobile device for a battle-tested solution. Plus, Shopify's award-winning help is there to support your success every step of the way. Do retail right with Shopify. Sign up for a $1 per month trial period at shopify.com/founderhour. Once again, go to shopify.com/founderhour to take your retail business to the next level today.
You know, Max, I'm curious, at this point, you obviously had, a couple of success stories. Was it like, other than, you wanted to solve this problem, I want to assume that you didn't need the money or you weren't doing it for the money. What like keeps you going? Like even now, I'm sure you could just be like Peter Thiel and go invest in companies and go fund other founders. And I'm sure you do that too, but why continue building?
I love the process of building. If anything, more than anything else, like the last night I was trying to stay awake, trying to get Llama 3.1 going on one of my many computers here because it's so cool. Like I got to tinker with that. And so I love building. I majored in computer science in the School of Engineering. And like when people ask me like at the core, who are you, Max? My answer is always, I'm an engineer. Like I love building. Like it's sometimes it's bridges, sometimes it's building, sometimes it's code, but all of us engineers have this passion to see something come from nothing, and like this satisfaction you get from building things, solving problems is really powerful. And so before anything else, before money, before success, just the idea of solving problems to build solutions is really powerful. So that's the driver.
What is your relationship, or like what is your mindset on money, like right in connection to building, right? I think some people see it as a reward, other people see it as kind of like a goal marker, right? What is your relationship like, or your mindset like with money? Because at the end of the day, you are building these companies, it makes money, you pay people, it's their livelihood, it's your livelihood. I'm just curious, like as someone who's now done this more than three times, for the younger entrepreneurs or entrepreneurs that are listening, I think it is helpful to understand what a successful founder's relationship with money is like. So would love to hear that perspective from you.
I think there are multiple layers. Obviously, if you're deeply uncomfortable, it becomes sort of, you can't have oxygen 98% of the time. You have to breathe all the time. And so I can definitely understand people who say, well, it's lofty for you to talk about all these idealistic views of money. Right now, I just got to pay rent or got to pay my team. And I think there's no skipping that part. And so having been successful a couple of times, I am in an easier place, and I fully recognize that. So today, I think of money primarily as capital. And as you age, or as I age, I just turned 49, so I'd like to believe I'm not at the midlife crisis yet, but I'm dangerously close to having a midlife crisis, I think. I don't know what what feels like, so maybe I won't notice.
We'll talk to you next year and see what that's like.
I'm hoping that even then I won't be in the midlife crisis point.
I'm just joking.
But the thing that happens to you as you sort of get older, you want to make greater impact. You sort of look at the set of opportunities and you ask yourself, well, what can I do that will really leave a mark, hopefully a positive mark? And one of the key tools you have, as someone who lives in late stage capitalism, to really leave a mark is to have access to capital. If you are waking up one morning and you're saying, I'm going to build an enormous thing, it's going to fix, access to water. We have incredible amounts of water. Most of it is salty. We got to desalinate it. You can invent a really cool idea how to desalinate water, but desalination technologies, that's the term.
Yeah, desalination, yeah.
But yeah. I don't think you get to bring it to market unless you have access to incredible amounts of capital, because it's not just that, it's transport and energy and all these things. And so if you wanted to build a company to give lots of people access to fresh water by way of turning salt water into fresh water, you need lots and lots of capital. And so access to money, access to capital from past successes is something of a springboard to try for bigger things. And that's why you see people like Elon and Jeff Bezos and all these people with sort of extreme wealth only pick these incredibly important, incredibly significant challenges where capital is a giant advantage or, you know, a way to propel past the first few stages of difficulty.
It's like these moonshot projects, basically, that, you know, you can only even, not even comprehend, but just even get started by having access to not only your own capital, but the capital of those around you that have a similar, you know, are in a similar situation.
Yeah. And so that's primarily sort of my primary relationship with money is the question, how can I maximize capital that I have access to really build something that's truly interesting, truly impactful? And then it is a sort of fungible measuring stick. Like, you can ask yourself, how am I doing relative to other people? Am I creating value? And when you create value, you can say, well, you know, I've helped people do X or Y. One way to measure it is through money. Although, for what it's worth, my personal favorite metric of impact I've had in the world has always been, for at least a very long time, has been the count of lives my products have changed for the better. Like, when I ask my team, my investors, are we happy with what a firm has done? So back and say, well, you know what, we've rendered a credit decision for north of 50 million people. We've transacted with north of 40 million people. Every time there were no late fees, no compounding interest, no deferred interest, none of the sort of things that I was rebelling against when we started the company, I can swear in a stack of Bibles that those people's lives have been changed for the better. It cost them less money. They did not feel trapped. They were not pushed into debt they didn't need. So that's 40 million people worth of Americans who have benefited from a product that I started up. That's a very good feeling. Like, you don't have to think of it in terms of dollars. You can think of it in terms of human lives. And that's what the mission of a firm from day zero has been: building honest financial products to improve lives. And the improve lives point is the actual counter of success. But dollars is a pretty good way of asking the question, well, how far can you take it? How big can you, be? We do live in capitalism. If the company was non-profitable forever or intentionally lost money like a nonprofit would, it'd be a lot harder to expand the reach. And so the drive to be profitable, the drive to create more dollarized value is there, even in the service of this mission of improving lives.
Yeah. You talk about how the early sort of vision for a firm was building a better credit score. And then, you know, I know you have some, like, thoughts on credit cards and how, the impact that credit cards have. And since they were introduced, I think in like the mid to late 50s, you know, consumer behavior and like has just been, it seems like it hasn't been changed much. Like, that's just what it is. And, you know, we're just gotten used to paying all these fees and, you know, hidden fees and all these things. I'm curious, you know, moving forward and like in terms of the future of a firm, what you're sort of doing and trying to do when it comes to that sort of aspect of credit and lending in that world.
So the interesting thing is that before lines of credit, revolving lines of credit, which is what sort of the underlying financial product beneath or behind a credit card is, a revolving line of credit. It is extraordinarily versatile. It's this thing that is kind of the greatest invention in many ways, right? It's like, you can just always put it in your plastic. It adds up to this total number. It costs you something. It's a little bit difficult to comprehend exactly what it costs you. So long as you're kind of paying it off, maybe at the end of the month, it's almost free. You're getting free float. If you're not paying it off at the end of the month, that's okay too. You're making a minimum payment. You're just going to kind of drift through life with a little bit of debt. But leverage is good. Like, having credit, having access to credit is a good thing. And if you're not careful, you find yourself thousands of dollars in debt, paying lots of interest, and basically having no idea how to get out of it. And that's what half of Americans are revolving, which is they're paying interest on a balance and they don't really have a plan or a way to get out of it. And it's sort of a classic example of a power tool that came with no manual and safety switched off, where if you are not fully aware of all the potential traps or potential pitfalls, you will likely find yourself in a bad situation. And the backing out of that door is really, really difficult. Before credit cards were introduced, we had charge cards and many flavors of charge cards where it was actually a little bit more cumbersome, but every transaction was deliberate. You would say, hey, I want to buy that on installment. And your card would tell you, okay, cool, that's the schedule. And you're going to be done in 6 months, or you'd be done in you know, some number of months or years. And buying anything was a little bit like buying a car or a house, where you had a plan and you knew pretty well. And maybe there were some penalties for being late, but there were definitely no opportunity to say, I actually never want to get out of debt. I would like to stay in debt forever and pay this, you know, for years and years and years. Credit cards made it easier to buy, which is how we went from charge cards, which were primarily used for what's called considered purchases, where you were like, I'm going to buy a couch. It's a couple hundred dollars. It's a little expensive. I'm going to pay for it over time. To, I'm just going to swipe my card for everything from my gas purchase for my car to a donut to a cup of coffee to a couch. And I believe with credit cards, certainly with revolving lines of credit, we gained a ton of user simplicity or availability and ease of use, but we lost a lot of the built-in mechanisms for not getting too far ahead of yourself. Basically, we went from thinking that credit is good and debt is not so good to thinking credit, debt, all the same thing. Just buy, 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 and we'll figure it out later. And when we, as we were building a firm, as we are building a firm, we had unwound a lot of these bad behaviors that credit cards invite you, entice you even to engage in, into more like a charge card behavior, where we said, you need to think about each transaction you make. It's a good idea to know when you're borrowing money. It's a good idea to know when you're going to be out of debt. Like, it is okay to borrow money. I went to college from my extremely poor beginnings and borrowed lots of money for my student loans, and I paid them off as the sort of I was able to. And without it, I would never have been where I am. Like, I wouldn't have had my CS degree. I wouldn't have met all these cool people. So student loans, and by extension, other types of loans that are quite deliberate and thoughtful, are a way to propel yourself in life, all the way down to borrowing some money to buy a nice suit to have a good outcome in a job interview. That's your first job, something like that. But if you are borrowing money indiscriminately for every little transaction and paying interest, and this interest eventually becomes interest on interest, et cetera, you're kind of digging your own hole. Like, it is not a good idea. And the big bet of the early firm was, can we even persuade people to put down this, just put it all on the card and, you know, think about it later behavior, and actually become more deliberate? And lots of people told me in the moment that when we were starting the company, like, it will never happen. Like, America, it's too late. Like, if you want to do this in some third world country where they have no access to credit, this would be a good alternative. But because credit cards are so versatile and so easy to use, it's too late. You're never going to convince people to back out of the behavior. And I just refused to believe it. And so did my co-founder, so did my early team. So looking back, you know, 13-ish years, we're doing tens of billions of dollars of volume. Every single transaction is a deliberate decision by the borrower to say, hey, I am keen on paying for this thing over time. And I'm also excited about the sense of control that I get by knowing when I'm done paying this thing off. And like, that feeling of satisfaction of, I'm not going to be in debt forever, is very powerful. It turned out to be as powerful a motivator and a mechanism for user acquisition and repeat as the simplicity of use that credit cards offer. And so the next few steps of this is all about expanding it to other purchases, smaller purchases, things that actually you would do kind of thoughtlessly. Like, you should not be paying interest on a cup of coffee. One of my best moments ever was, I was on live TV and I was telling an anchor sort of version of the story, like, here's what we're doing, here's why it sucks to be in debt for donuts and coffee. And she's like, no, but that doesn't happen. I'm like, well, do you have a balance? I asked her. She's like, yeah, I have a balance on my credit card. I'm like, okay, if you haven't paid off your balance in full last month, you're paying interest on every cup of coffee you buy with your credit card. And she sort of thought about it for a second, like, you're right. That's so stupid. Like, I don't think it's stupid. I think it's easy. I think it's the thing that the system is designed to promote. And I don't think it should be that way. There should be a card that says, that's a really small transaction. You don't want to pay interest on that. It makes no sense. Certainly not interest on that interest over time. And that's what Affirm Card solves. So we launched a card, which is neither a credit card nor a debit card. It knows how to do both. Some transactions are too small and you should just pay for them and be done. And some transactions are big and deliberate and you should pay for them over time. That's what Affirm Card does. And we now have well north of a million users for that thing. And it's growing really nicely. So there is this demand for more honest financial products that people actually prefer to use, even if they are intentionally slightly more cumbersome, slightly more intentional, pardon the pun, to use.
So Max, one of the things that, you know, I think about, and I think I've also read about it from several people and critics of, you know, buy now, pay later type programs, of also like all the downsides of buy now, pay later, and how, you know, does it lead to overspending? Does it lead to people having more bad debt, right? There's thousands of millions of things I'm sure you've heard or you hear every day. I'm sure there's reviews on you guys that say all those things. But, you know, finance is such a personalized thing, right? Like, you know, I have a certain amount of money in my bank account and my investments. I make a certain amount of money. You know, how is or has or will a firm, you know, customize or personalize, or is that something in the plans of like, okay, I have this card, you know, a firm knows Nerses gets X amount of income per month. He has X amount of expenses per month, right? Like essentially like through whatever AI or other sorts of tools learns that, hey, Nerses, you know what? Maybe you shouldn't be buying this, right? Because yes, everything's a choice. You know, you have the choice to buy or not buy, to restrict yourself, refrain from buying stuff. But when you have something so easy in your hand, the plastic piece of card, it's easy to just say, you know, fuck it, I'm just going to buy it. You know, how are you guys also dealing with some of the negative stuff that comes out of, you know, having this easy access to this plastic, not only yours, but of any kind? Because I do see it becoming a growing, if not, it's already some sort of an epidemic, like honestly, that's growing and continues to grow. And, you know, I think will hurt our country and our people.
So, great question. There's a couple of things that we have done from the very beginning. And so, one really key thing to understand about a firm, the reason we don't charge late fees is not because it is somehow inherently a bad idea. Like the notion of you've misbehaved, you should have some sort of a negative consequence of your misbehavior is actually not form. Like I'm not so altruistic that if you just routinely refuse to pay on time, there shouldn't be a penalty for you. The problem with late fees and many other forms of sort of punitive behavior by financial service providers is it goes from being a reason to remind you that you should be thoughtful about your behavior, it pretty quickly turns into a profit center that rewards the credit provider for your bad behavior. And at the limit, which is not actually very difficult to see, it becomes a thing where your bank bets against you. Like when you're given a card, the statement every time on the back of your credit card statement, it says, hey, you should probably pay this thing off in full, because if you don't, you'll pay a lot of interest. But it's in really, really small print. And on a front page, it says, hey, the minimum payment is this. And you're like, the default is a minimum payment, so I guess I'll do that. And so you'll pay a lot of interest. The other thing that it says is, hey, it's no cost to you to pay us back. Obviously, we're not going to charge you money for paying us. But if you're late, there's a $38 late fee. And that is 100% gross profit product. Like, and so because the fees are so enormous, anyone with half a brain should understand that anyone who charges you late fees kind of really wants you to be late, because they will make a lot of money. And the reason we decided we will not charge late fees ever is so that we would align our financial interest with the best behavior for you. And so when we lend money to you, we tell you explicitly, hey, you should be on time. If you're not on time, it's bad for you, because you're going to eventually damage your credit rating and it's going to have some pretty negative repercussions in your life. But we are not going to benefit from it. We are very motivated to remind you to be on time, which means also in the moment when we decide whether it's a yes or a no for this transaction, we have all the incentives in the world to only lend money, to only approve transactions where we know or we think we know you will pay us back. You have both the ability to pay us back and a desire to do so. If we think, we're not really sure you're going to pay us back, we are probably going to do a terrible mistake if we gave you money anyway, because at worst, we're never going to see it again. But at best, you're just going to be constantly late and we'll lose money on just that sheer lateness and lateness and lateness. And so the structural do not benefit from misfortunes or mistakes of your customers, which is an unwritten value at a firm, is actually really powerful. It forces us to do an underwriting decision every single time to make sure that we are not overextending you, that we're not putting you in a position where you're going, oh, fuck it, I'll buy it. I'm just not sure I'm going to be able to afford it later. And so that doesn't happen with us. There's the proof's in the pudding, but if you watch our public filings, you'll see that we've maintained really, really good credit results all through the ups and downs from the pandemic to the current strangeness with the really high interest rates from the Fed, et cetera. And that is because we don't measure ourselves with strictly the measuring stick of, well, is it profitable or not? It's also, is it profitable? And do we have conviction that this person will actually pay us back reliably and on time? Because we won't benefit. We'll only be worse off if they don't. So that's how we solve this problem. I would argue that overall, the industry should consider aligning itself with its customers, which is, sounds like a strange idea for financial services, but it's the only it's the only industry in the world where the provider routinely bets against their own customer. In most places, and if you're coming in, the business wants you to succeed. It's a fair trade. You pay them money, they give you a service, and then everybody's happy.
And a gym. A gym is another one that needs to align their interests.
Yeah, there's actually a handle. I once said this to someone who said, well, that and the diet drugs. Like if you're trying to lose weight, they don't want you to be too successful.
Ozempic.
Yeah, it's like I think someone just lost 40% of their market cap today announcing that Ozempic has been too effective and their patients are not having as much need for their some other drug that they're using to help them manage obesity. And it's like, this is a very strange, I mean, that if you ever want to like exhibit A in late stage capitalism, eating itself alive, that was a fine example of like, it's not as valuable anymore. People are too successful losing weight. But the punchline is we align with our customers every single time. I love the idea. Every time regulators go after excessive fees, junk fees, whatever you want to call them, I think the industry groans because it eliminates margin. In our case, I sort of have a small celebratory dance because we don't charge those fees anyway. And I'm excited to see those things pushed off the map. But yeah. It is true that America loves debt. Like this is not, you know, at the national level all the way down to individual level. And using credit thoughtfully is a great idea. Abusing it, turning it into permanent debt is a terrible idea. And you have to find the happy medium.
Yeah. And I think a lot of it also comes down to education or lack thereof of how any of this stuff works. I mean, you know, you have these college students that sign, myself, Pat included, like, you know, we went to college, had student loans, still pay them off. And you're not really well educated on them, right? It's a quick, like, you know what, here you go, here's the paper online, whatever, sign it and boom, $100,000, $200,000. And you're good to go. And you start living this grandiose lifestyle. And then you get out of college and you're like, oh my God, I don't have money. Right. So, I mean, you know how the cycle goes. But I couldn't agree more. I do think, and Pat and I talk about this all the time, a lot of this stuff comes down to we are just not educated enough, right? From fintech, from finance, right? To food, to medicine. We as Americans, I just feel like, and again, I'm blaming all of us, we just don't know enough. Even with all this access, you know, to information, we just don't know enough. And Max, we could sit here and ask you thousands more questions, but you know, for the sake of your time and ours, one final question that I have is, you know, you've been in technology since you were 10 years old, you said, so going on 40 years now. You've seen a lot, you've done a lot, you've built a lot. You know, I know it's a broad general question that I'm going to ask, but what is the future of technology and what excites you the most, more so, with technology and the impacts it can have on society?
I think the cool thing about technology is that it changes all the time. So to sort of say, well, you know, the next thing that's going to excite me is X is definitionally temporary. Right now, obviously, you know, I'm tinkering with Llama. So you can guess what I'm excited about in my copious spare time. I do think that AI is going to be this incredibly important set of technologies and discoveries. And I have a very benign point of view on it. There's plenty of people who are terrified of, like, you know, it runs away from us and starts nuclear wars and all that stuff. I think that's mostly nonsense. And obviously, it can turn technology for the worse. But I think most of the time, maybe all of the time, it will just make us superhuman. Like, you know, when I was a kid, I was reading about exoskeletons and like things that, you know, make you run faster and give you superpowers and you can lift heavier things and wield more powerful tools. And AI is this super powerful tool that takes your handheld computer and in the cloud has this infinitely intelligent brain that can help you solve whatever problems in front of you. We're going to take that very, very far. Like, I don't think it's going to eliminate the need for software engineers. It's just going to make software engineers a lot more productive. Crappy software engineers are going to be pretty good, and the pretty good ones are going to be extraordinary. And the extraordinary ones are probably going to push the AI tools to be ultra amazing and sort of invent the next generation. So we're going to pull up all the people, I hope, into a better, more interesting way of living and being more productive. So I think that's going to be quite powerful. And within that, we're undoubtedly going to invent something new that's going to be technology unlike we've seen before. And like the one that I sort of, I'm a big fan of finding inspiration in science fiction, just because most creative people are not limited by what they see on today's technology map as a doable and not doable. They just kind of say, well, you know what, there's a thing, they plug it into your brain and suddenly you're online. And I'm a huge fan of the cyberpunk genre from the late 80s, early 90s. And so brain plugs and being sort of jacked in directly to your neural network from the biggest neural networks inside computers to your own, that's definitely coming at some point. That's going to be pretty amazing. And after that, there'll be something else. Like, I don't think it's possible to imagine the next 10 years of technology. And if anything, it's all speeding up. And you know, if there is a risk, it's not that it's going to change the world for the worse in some incredible moment that we all miss. It's that if you blink, the changes for the better happen too quickly and you won't be able to give them proper credit. But you know, I think we're all going to enjoy it.
Yeah. Well, Max, this has been a pleasure and a wonderful conversation. And we appreciate you coming on the show and chatting with us.
Thank you. It was fun.